evening, everyone. Welcome to any visitors who are joining us this evening, and a special welcome to all those who are watching on the internet. We hope that you will feel part of our fellowship as we worship God together. In between today and tomorrow, God loves us. In between the waiting and the knowing, God is with us. In between the not yet and the coming soon, God is there waiting. It feels like we are between worlds, where the light shifts and the darkness envelops. It's a liminal moment of words unsaid and hopes crushed. In such a moment, we find ourselves uncertain of where to go. All we can do is be here and believe. Let's open our worship this evening by singing together How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
Let us come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we have come to wait in Christ. We have come as very different people. We have different hopes and fears, different needs and different questions. We have different dreams and different concerns. We have different hurts and different experiences. We have received different gifts and different talents, and we have different expectations and different ways of worshipping you. But we come because we are one in Christ, who calls us to come. Lord, we come to wait for your life-giving, life-renewing Spirit. We come for his infilling, life-changing power. We wait, as the disciples did, for signs of your powerful presence and for evidence of your cleansing grace. We come to wait for the Spirit's guidance, his encouragement and his enabling. Lord, we come to wait as we are, always waiting for you to make us the people you meant us to be. We wait to give you thanks and praise, honour and glory. We wait to receive all your resources of hope, peace and love, and your offer of our place in the heaven of your love, where all our waiting ends. We come, and in coming, bring our prayers in Christ's name. Amen.
They have not known either the Father or me. But I have told you this so that when the time comes for them to do these things, you will remember what I told you. I did not tell you these things at the beginning, for I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me where I am going. And now that I have told you, telling you the truth. It's better for you that I go away, because if I do not go, the Helper will not come to you. But if I do go away, then I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove to the people of the world that they are wrong about sin and about what is right and about God's judgment. They are wrong about sin because they do not believe in me. They are wrong about what is right, because I am going to the Father and you will not see me anymore. And they are wrong about judgment, because the ruler of this world has already been judged. I have much more to tell you, but now it would be too much for you to bear. When, however, the Spirit comes, who reveals the truth about God, he will lead you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but he will speak of what he hears and will tell you of things to come. He will give me glory, because he will take what I say and tell it to you. All that my Father has is mine. That is why I said that the Spirit will take what I give him and tell it to you. Let's continue our praise now by saying, Spirit of God. struggling with the reality of having to let him go. They had been with him for a long time, and they depended on him. They'd left their homes and families to follow him, and the thought of Jesus no longer being with them was more than they could grasp or imagine. Jesus is quick to reassure them. Yes, he will no longer be with them, but he promises never to leave them alone. He tells them that he will send the Holy Spirit to them. He also tells them that it will be better if he does leave them, because if he stays, the Spirit will not come to them. Imagine what the disciples were thinking and feeling as Jesus talked about leaving them. They'd been with him for 3 years. He was their leader and their teacher. If he was no longer with them, what would they do? Let us ask ourselves at this point, what would we do if Jesus was not in our life? Would we miss him? Or would we even notice his absence? How would his absence affect us? How would your life and my life be different if Jesus was not present with us? Sometimes we may feel as if Jesus is far away from us. Why is this? Why does Jesus seem far from us at times? If we think about this question, it's actually not Jesus who's far from us, but we who are far from him. In life, separation and loss of relationship can often lead to grief and pain. The disciples were filled with sorrow when Jesus spoke about his imminent departure. But Jesus explains to them that it was for their sake that he must leave them and return to his Father. The writer John stresses here that the Holy Spirit, as a continuing presence of Jesus within the Christian community, will lead us to truth. For John, then, the church need not be afraid of practicing its faith in Jesus in the midst of a changing world marked by Jesus' physical absence. The question we are left with is whether we will listen to the Holy Spirit and be open to newer and deeper understandings of our faith and to the implications of Jesus' revelation for us today. Nowadays, the internet, social media, and 24-hour news give us a more immediate awareness of local, national, and global crises that challenge us for a Christian response. So what should our Christian response to such crises be? Can we, like John, trust the Spirit to guide us in discerning what it means to live out Christian faith today? We as a church, as a community, as individuals, need the constant guidance of the Holy Spirit to help us remain faithful to the truth. And our mind should always be open to understanding it more deeply so that we can pass it on to others. We too, however, like the disciples, need time to understand what Jesus is saying. But it's not a question of theoretical knowledge, but of things of the heart. The meaning of love, of suffering, the presence of God in our lives and in that of others. Jesus is sensitive to disciples' limited understanding. By telling them, he has more to tell them. He is in a gentle way preparing them for what is to come. Jesus knows too how anxious we can be, both to let go of the past and to trust what the future of our life living for him will bring. Can we speak to him about our anxieties? As our journey through life continues, the Holy Spirit gradually unfolds Jesus' message to us, so that it speaks to us at appropriate times in our lives. So what is the Holy Spirit trying to say to you and me this evening? Let us hold on to these thoughts as we sing our next song, Spirit of the Living God. Continuing to read from John, from verses 16 to 28. In a little while, you will not see me anymore, and then a little while later, you will see me. Some of his disciples asked among themselves, "What does this mean? He tells us that in a little while we will not see him, and then a little while later we will see him." And he also says, "It's because I'm going to the Father." What does this "a little while" mean? We don't know what he's talking about. Jesus knew that they wanted to question him. So he said to them, "I said, in a little while you will not see me, and then a little while later you will see me. Is this what you're asking about among yourselves? I'm telling you the truth. You will cry and weep, but the world will be glad. You will be sad, but your sadness will turn into gladness. When a woman is about to give birth, she's sad because her hour of suffering has come. But when the baby is born, she forgets about her suffering because she's happy that a baby has been born into the world. That is how it is with you. Now you are sad, but I will see you again, and your hearts will be filled with gladness, the kind of gladness that no one can take away from you. When that day comes, you will not ask me for anything. I'm telling you the truth. The Father will give you whatever you ask of him in my name. Until now, you've not asked for anything in my name. Ask, and you will receive, so that your happiness may be complete. I've used figures of speech to tell you these things, but the time will come when I will not use figures of speech, but will speak to you plainly about the Father. When that day comes, you will ask him in my name. And I do not say that I will ask him in your behalf, For the Father himself loves you. He loves you because you love me and have believed that I came from God. I did come from the Father and came into the world, and now I'm leaving the world and going to the Father. Amen. Jesus is telling his disciples here that he will be gone from them in the form that is familiar to them. But in a little while, they will experience him again in a mysterious new form. This phrase, a little while, is repeatedly used in this short passage. A little while may refer to the 3 days between the death of Jesus and his resurrection. But it may also be the time between the first and the second coming of Christ, the time in which we live. Jesus does not mince his words in this passage. He tells us that our life will not be free from pain. But he also promises us that our mourning will turn to hope and our pain to joy. God's time and God's ways are not ours. God's little while can seem like a lifetime to us. Do we sometimes want God to hurry up in healing people, or to hurry up in sorting things out for us? Though we may not see how God is working, do we trust that God is hard at work in the world and in our own lives? Or are we sometimes like the disciples in today's passage? Do we get irritated by some of Jesus' words because we don't understand them? We need to remind ourselves to move from our head to our heart, as this is where the Holy Spirit will guide us into the truth of whatever Jesus has to say to us. What Jesus said was not always understood by the disciples, and sometimes their talking to each other seemed only to give rise to more questions, just as sometimes is the case with us. Let's take a moment to remember a difficult time in our lives. This may have been a time when you experienced an illness, difficult challenges in a relationship, or a loss of some sort. What were the emotions you experienced during this time? Was it anger? Fear, sadness, grief, loss, or all of them? Did you have a sense of the presence of God with you at that time? Or did you feel lost, alone, and afraid? Jesus warns his disciples here that difficult days will come. There will be times when they will weep, mourn and grieve, but there will also be times when their grief will be turned into joy. To help his disciples understand this, Jesus uses the image of a woman who is in labour. Yes, the labour is difficult and the pain is excruciating. However, when a child is born, there is no greater joy. A new life has come into the world, a tremendous gift has been born from all that pain. The analogy Jesus uses fits exactly with what happened to the disciples. When Jesus was arrested and crucified, they were terrified and disappointed. But after the resurrection, they experienced a great joy. Then during Pentecost, they were fully empowered to continue the mission of proclaiming the gospel of truth. Jesus wants his disciples to know and believe that after these difficult days of his crucifixion and death, there will be new life. Indeed, there is no gain without pain. Life is full of pain and suffering, but when that happens, Jesus wants us to know and believe that he will grant us the strength to bear the pain. He wants us to know that after the difficult days, we will experience new life and new hope. Our part is to trust and to be watchful and attentive to Jesus' coming. This is often easier said than done. We may know Jesus will come again, but when life is difficult and painful, we may not trust that new life and hope will ever return to us. If we truly trust Jesus, however, we will stay in the journey despite the difficulty and the pain. Jesus uses these situations in our lives as an opportunity to help us grow in trust and to deepen our relationship with him. The reality is that Jesus is always with us. Jesus promised to be with us until the end of time. Will our minds, our eyes and hearts be open to his coming? Let's hope so. Amen. Let's continue our worship by singing, "I cannot tell by he whom angels worship."
Thank you. Meditation of John. One day we'll see him again. Don't ask me when, don't ask me how, but one day, when all this struggle is over, all the pain, all the grief, all the fear, all the doubt, then he will return to establish his kingdom. I know that's hard to believe sometimes, when you keep on battling against the odds and nothing seems to change. When you stand up for what is good, yet evil seems to triumph. When love is met with hatred, gentleness with violence, truth with falsehood. Of course you start to wonder. When you're faced with suffering, sickness, death, when greed and corruption are rewarded with plenty and justice is trampled underfoot, when the poor get poorer and the world goes by uncaring. It's impossible not to ask yourself day after day why it's allowed to happen. But he will come. I'm certain of it. Not just because he promised to, though that's important, of course. Not simply because he came back before, cheating death of its victory, triumphing over the grave, though that's more still vital still. But because he has to. If anything is finally to make sense, if faith is to be anything more than a grand delusion, and it is more, it has to be. These goals we strive towards, this life revealed in Christ, the promises he made, the truths he taught, everything he lived and died for, they're real. I know that. For they have turned my life around, sustained me through my darkest moments, lifted me beyond my highest thoughts, and given me a joy that knows no bounds. So though now we see, but do not understand, though faith is sometimes hard, and Christ seems far away, we'll hold fast to hope, waiting for a time when there will be an end to tears and pain and death. A time when God will live among his people in a new and beautiful kingdom. And we shall see him again, our Lord Jesus Christ, crowned in glory and splendor, King of kings, Lord of lords, all in all, yet one with us. We now bring to God our prayer of intercession. Let us pray. God of love, hear the cry of those who yearn for love. Fractured families, broken homes, neglected, unwanted, alone. God of love, hear our prayer. God of justice, hear our cry for those who yearn for justice. Persecuted and oppressed, exploited, ill-treated, broken. God of justice, hear our prayer. God of peace, hear the cry of those who yearn for peace in battle zones and broken regions, frightened, fearful, anxious. God of peace, hear our prayer. God of healing, hear the cry of those who yearn for healing, physical and spiritual, hurting, weakened, depressed. God of healing, hear our prayer. God of mercy, hear the cry of those who yearn for mercy, convicted in need of your grace, contrite, humble, bowed down. God of mercy, hear our prayer. God of all, may we know the peace of God, the love of God, the healing and mercy of God, now and always. Amen. Let us worship God as we sing our closing hymn, In Christ Alone.
Thank you.
May we travel now into the story of light, even as the darkness comes, and kindle a flame that dares us to believe this is not the end.